to do is to make, but I'm just thankful for what I've got. I've been down to down the one, but I know where my help comes from. Right on time, ain't that just like God? I see blessings falling out of nowhere, and I'm thinking, ain't that just like God?
that you're seated upon the throne. I know he's right here inside my home. I've got a treasure here in my heart, and in my weakness it won't depart. I have a Savior who will abide. He's not just with me, he lives inside. Just go as Daniel lives. Our God will bring you out, and he will test you.
2012, I would go out and I would minister. Chandler was just talking about it. I would minister to people and I would watch them be healed, set free, and delivered. And I would go home for days in the dark, under the covers with the curtains closed. I was plagued by depression and rejection.
January 30th, 2020, that is the day that my father passed away. So he passed away from COVID. Within the mourning period and just trying to get life back from dealing with that, you know, we decided that we wanted to have a baby. Like, whoo. We find out that we are pregnant on my father's birthday. And when we are about 10 and a half, 11 weeks, we miscarry. It was one of those, we just have to trust that this just wasn't the time. And so once we let go, we started looking for a house. So we were in the market. We bought our house and we're like ready to start celebrating and getting, you know, the house warming together. And the doctor calls and they're like, hey, let's, you know, we never got a zero read on your hormone level. And I want to be able to give you the green light so you guys can start trying again. So when we do the sonogram tech, as soon as she touches me with this machine, you literally see an entire spine across the screen.
Yes.
It was a full baby in there. So we literally had just weeks to prepare for this baby that we thought, you know, we had lost.
We always say he's our miracle child.
Yeah, definitely a living, breathing, in your face miracle. Yeah.
So it really helped me understand the power of prayer and the belief in having faith and never giving up.
Me personally, I wanted to make a public declaration of my faith. One, I've never been baptized. My mom was always very strict and just said, you know, you make the decision when it's time. As an adult, I understand the importance of it, and I wanted to make sure that I did what was right for me. I also want to set that example for my kids.
When I was younger, I got baptized because they told me I was supposed to. Now I'm genuinely getting baptized for me and for my family to rededicate my life fully to God like it's supposed to be in a genuine way. And not just because it was something that I was told when I was younger that I had to get done.
I'm just hoping to gain a deeper connection with God.
Well, what I hope to gain today, honestly, is to continue walking in the faith of the Lord and continue to see the greater blessings that He has for us and understand my full commitment to my Lord and Savior. If you're on the edge of whether you should get baptized or not, trust in God and follow His word, and to lead you down the right path, because your heart is always going to be your true path, because that's where God always touches.
You've already gone through and gone down every other path, so why not see what's on the other side of obedience?
Hey y'all, I'm Nora.
And I'm Brooklyn. We want to welcome you to our Youth Sunday worship experience. If you are tuning in online, go ahead and share the live with someone and chat with our team in real time.
If this is your first time worshiping with us and you are online, please stay connected. Visit concorddallas.org/connect. And if you are in the building and this is your first time in the building, we have something special for you. So stop by the Next Steps area located in the foyer on your way out.
Remember that you give at any time during the service. We have four ways to do that. You can scan a QR code, text the word GIVE to 43905, visit concorddallas.org/give, or drop in one of the boxes throughout the building.
New members, we want to fellowship with you. Meet Pastor Carter and get connected with the other new members and the ministries offered here at Concord, happening on April 28th, 2024, and the Legacy Center at 12:45 p.m. right after the second service.
If you are looking for an opportunity to serve, we have one coming up. We need volunteers for the 2024 E.K. Bailey Preaching Conference happening July 8th through the 10th. This volunteer moment is just for you. Text SERVE to 43905 or meet in the foyer inside the Next Steps room immediately after service for more information.
The special bond election early voting begins on Monday, May April 22nd through Tuesday, April 30th, and election day is on Saturday, May 4th.
And for the primary party runoff, early voting begins on Monday, May 20th through Friday, May 24th. Election day is on Tuesday, May 28th.
Young adults, meet us at the On the Levee, April 24th at 7 p.m. for the table. There will be worship, Q&A, and a mixer. And make sure you invite someone to join you.
The Shops at Redbird's news event is Spring Fest, happening Saturday, April 27th from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. This family-friendly event will feature music vibes, food trucks, yard games, interactive attractions, local food, and so much more. There is plenty of fun in store, so come on out and enjoy everything this exciting event has to offer.
Let's watch this quick video, and then we'll start worship.
Could have just seen, I said, go get the chopper. No, I'm a win, I could do this for hours. I got that truth, I got heavenly power, yeah.
Sometimes we are so much in our feelings that it makes us a little dumb. We have to find a way, like Mary did, to be in our feelings but still be active.
Sometimes you may enter into an assignment that wasn't a God's assignment, but that's where Romans 8:28 comes in. All things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and God are called according to his purpose, meaning that he can even use your mistake to put you on the path where he's called you to be.
I feel like a poet, through all the lies, I knew I was chosen. Walking with God, you thought I was joking. He made a king, you thought I was broken. I went and opened the book.
Darius Daniel says the enemy wants to use agitation to have you abandon your assignment.
Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that? Why would I stress about that?
Good morning, Concord. It's so glad to see y'all this morning. Can y'all stand on your feet? We're getting ready to go up and worship this morning. Hallelujah. How many of y'all serve an awesome God this morning? I know I do. I serve an awesome God. He is worthy to be praised. We're getting ready to go up and worship. Come on, let me see you clap like this. I see it. Father, we thank you for being an awesome God this morning. You woke us up this morning, and we are glad to be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Song is simple, we said, yeah. Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are awesome. Yeah. Lord, you are awesome. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you are awesome. Come on, can we sing that all over the room?
Lord, you are awesome.
Yes, you are, Lord.
Lord, you are awesome.
If he woke you up this morning, let me see you wave your hand.
Lord, you are awesome.
Lord, you've been so good.
Lord, you are awesome.
Next part says, was it for you?
Was it for your love?
Was it for your grace?
Was it for your grace?
I don't know where I'll be.
For your grace.
I don't know where I'll be. Can we go up and worship? Yeah. Come on, let me hear you say. us your grace. Can I just see the hands of the people that he saved in this place? Come on, has he saved anybody's life in this place? Hallelujah. Anybody grateful for salvation, the chance we get? Thank you, Lord, for saving my life. Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise in this place. Yes, Lord, thank you for saving our life. What an awesome God we serve. Hallelujah. My God is awesome. He can move mountains. Sing it, church. Keep me. Have me from. Come on, say, my God, he heals me when I'm broken. Heals me, strength where I've been weakened. Say forever, for. Come on, let's sing it, team. Everybody, my God, say, my God. Come on, what can he do? Say,
he can move mountains.
If he's moved the mountain for you, you ought to believe it. Come on, hide me from the rain. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken. Strength where I've been weak. Somebody say, forever say. Let's go. Come on right here. Everybody. My God.
My God awesome. Is awesome.
Come on, if you believe it, you ought to lift your voice and say,
awesome.
I know God is awesome. Say,
awesome.
Sing awesome.
Awesome.
Come on, church. Say, of
Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess that he is the Lord. Somebody shout Jesus. Hallelujah. Clap your hands and give him praise. Woo, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Good morning, Concord family. Thank you so much for joining us in worship this morning. I want to remind you very quickly of a scripture passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. It tells us that he who sows sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he who sows bountifully shall reap how? Bountifully. What that simply means is you get what you give. God also goes on to let us know that he is the one that gives seed to the sower. And so he wouldn't give us the command to give without putting something in our hand to give. Isn't that right? And I know if you've been here 5 minutes or less, you know that Concord is good ground to sow into. Isn't that right? Praise God for a church that is good ground to sow into. At Concord Church, we grow people. And one of the ways that we're growing our elementary students is with Lemonade Day. Our third, fourth, and fifth graders have been learning entrepreneurial skills, marketing skills. Last week, they made pitches to investors to invest in their lemonade stand businesses. And when you come on May the 5th, you're going to see Concord covered in Lemonade Day stands. These kids have gotten with teams. They've come up with their own recipes. They've done their own designs, and you'll have the opportunity to buy their lemonade. None of that would be possible without you partnering with us in your giving. So thank you, Concord, for partnering with us in giving. And I want to encourage you to continue on in that same way. Take a look at our screen. There are three different ways that you can give. You can go to our website, concorddallas.org/give. You can also text the word give to 43905. You can take your offering with you as you leave and drop it in the receptacle. Feel free to give one of two ways. You can give in our general offering, which furthers the mission and the vision of Concord Church. Or you can give a love offering to bless our pastor and family. Amen. I want to take a moment while you get your offering together, get ready to give. Let's pray together. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you and praise you today because you're good. We love you for your loving kindness and tender mercies. You are truly an awesome God. We thank you for giving us seed to sow. We thank you for giving us a church to sow into. And we pray that you will bless us because we are giving not of necessity, not grudgingly, oh God, but we're giving because we are cheerful givers. And your word says you love a cheerful giver. And so bless us today as we give cheerfully. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, please direct your attention to the screens.
Well, I have cousins out here, but I have a godmother. Her cousin lives out here. She's kind of like, so I consider that my family.
I wonder if I'm being awkward right now. Let me try to sit this way. Or maybe this way.
So I'm excited for it, because every single time we try
Dang, I wonder if I got something in my teeth. Let me check my phone real quick.
Look, y'all saw that video? That's awkward. That's called when your intrusive thoughts take over. You overthink. That's not what's about to happen over here at the Lincoln Alarm. Let me show y'all what's really about to go down. Now, y'all see that? That's what's really about to happen. Y'all, we about to show up and show out and have some fun. You know, we got urban trivia, a live band, a DJ, and even mocktails. So, fellas, go ahead and get registered to sign up, because you already know the ladies did. We got to show up in numbers. So, tune in, y'all. We'll see you on the link on the line.
Time worshipers, praise us in this place. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Anybody glad the Lord woke you up this morning? Come on, you made it to the house of the Lord. Can I just get about 50 blessed people in this house just to open your mouth and give them praise right now? Come on, you've got the activities of your limbs, and you got everything. You can wave your hand. You ought to stand up and say, thank you, Lord, for blessing me. Since he's in the blessing business, Lord, bless my neighbor, bless my mother, bless my father. Come on, everybody, get blessed. Give them praise in this place. Hallelujah. Come on, you're not acting like you're blessed.
Come on, you're not acting like you're blessed. If you got food on your table, a roof over your head, if you got your children, if you're in your right mind, somebody give them glory in this place if you're blessed. Hallelujah. Woo, thank you, Lord. Listen, tell your neighbor, say neighbor. Come on, holler at them. Say, you're blessed. Come on, tell them you're blessed. Come on, tell somebody down your road, you're blessed. You're blessed. Let's go, let's go. You're blessed. Come on, y'all got to turn up with us at 11 o'clock. Come on, right here. Come on, make some noise. Bless me. Come on, everybody, let's do it. I see you. Come on. Bless
me.
So everyone. Let all these folks. Come on, one more time. Say, bless me. You ought to tell somebody, hey, look, but so everyone, not just me, let all these folks. Let all these folks. Now, everybody, come on, go crazy. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Clap those hands. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Right here, say it. We've got it.
We got everything we need.
Come on, anybody blessed in the house, say it.
We got everything we need.
We got everything we need.
I got everything we need.
Come on. I'm the head and not the tail.
We got everything we need.
We're the lender, not the borrower.
We got everything we need.
Come on. We got everything we need.
We got everything we need.
I got everything we need.
I got everything.
Come on. Persecuted, not abandoned.
We got everything we need.
Criticized, but not forsaken.
We got everything we need.
I got the Lord on my side. Victory. Blessed. God, not just for me, but come on, let all these folks this week. Let all these folks.
Let all these folks this week. God have everything they need.
Come on, let everybody on my row be blessed. Somebody shout, I'm blessed. Come on, shout, I'm blessed. I'm blessed when I come. I'm blessed when I go. Listen, that's a praise moment right there. If you're blessed, you ought to give him glory right there. Come on. It could have been you outdoors. No food, no clothes. Come on, somebody. Thank God for blessing me. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands one more time. Yes, Lord. Tell somebody one more time you're blessed. Tell them you're blessed. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Since he's in a blessed business, anybody need grace today? Come on, anybody need God's grace? There are two twins called Grace and Mercy that's been following you every single day of your life. Come on, if you're grateful for God's grace, then Lord, I need your grace in this place. Hallelujah.
I needed your grace more than I thought I ever. You forgave more than I thought you ever could. And I was stronger in my head, but truth is, we need your grace.
Anybody need his grace in this place? Come on, can we sing it together? Say, I need it. Say, He forgave you, say,
You forgave.
Than I thought I ever would. Come on, we were stronger in our heads, say, I was stronger. But the truth is, come on, if you need your grace, this grace, you ought to lift your hands right there. Let's go. Everybody sing it ready, say. Come on, you can get it today. Sing it ready, say.
Sustain you, you ought to give him praise. And while you're putting your hands together, help me celebrate these young people. Y'all did a great job. Y'all did a great job. Thank you, guys. Y'all practiced, y'all prepared, y'all look good, you sound good. Thank you so much. Let's go to God together in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this grace of another day. We thank you, Lord, that grace has been at the center of everything. Your grace woke us up and has given us life and health and strength, and for that we say thank you. Your grace, Lord, has provided for us. Your grace has sustained us. Your grace has kept us through seasons of suffering in our lives, and for that we want to say thank you, God. So, Father, we don't want to take your grace for granted. You didn't have to do what you did, and so, Father, we come in just saying you thank you, Lord, for the ways you showed up, for the ways you've made ways, for the friends and family you sent us, for the ways you provided for us. We want to tell you, thank you, God. We honor you, we praise you, and Lord, would you bless this worship service? Thank you for these young people singing so passionately, serving your purpose today. We honor your name for all you're doing in the next generation. Matter of fact, Lord, we pray for everyone in this room under the age of 18. We pray right now, Lord, that you will use them on their campuses. We pray, Lord, that you would bless them in their studies, that you would bless them in their relationships and friendships, that you would bless them in their mental health, that you would bless them in their esteem, that they will know they are fearfully and wonderfully made, that you would keep them safe on the campus, that you would help them to make the honor roll. Lord, we pray for all of them in this room, and we thank you, Lord, for how you're moving in their lives. It's in Jesus' name that we say this prayer, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen, 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 amen. All right. We are so thankful for our next-gen ministry and all the Lord does through our children and our youth as we continue to, we just believe you got to invest in the future. And so we're grateful for them ministering, and we are grateful for you. To our first-time guests, we are super excited that you chose to worship with us, and we pray it is not the last time that you join us, but that you would come back again and again. We are grateful for you. If you have your Bibles, I want you to open to the book of James chapter 3. James chapter 3 is where we'll be looking for today. We have been in a series entitled Faith Work, and we've been walking through the book of James together. There is so much power in the Word of God, and we've been taking it section by section, and today we want to look at James chapter 3, verses 1 through 11. James chapter 3, verses 1 through 11. And it reads this way. Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways, and anyone who is never at fault of what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. We put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us. We can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so strong and driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire and a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil and full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it, we curse human beings who have been made in God's image. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. By brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same stream? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Amen. You may be seated. Somebody just say, ouch. I just all in my business today. Just, I didn't come for this, but it's here. The Lord knows exactly what we need. Would you just say something to your neighbor this morning? Just welcome them, tell them good morning. We are so thankful that you're here. You got to be nice to your neighbor. All right. All right, family. James chapter 3. Verse 1 through 12, I want to talk this morning from the subject of watch your mouth. Watch your mouth. Watch your mouth. Watch your mouth. I was 25 when I first joined staff at this church, and I was so excited. I had the opportunity to serve in ministry and work in ministry. A couple of years later, the senior pastor, Pastor E.K. Bailey, would invite me and the church to be the assistant pastor as well as his successor. And I was in this new role, kind of serving as over the staff and managing key projects for him. And on one appointment, on one particular occasion, he gave me an assignment. He said, Brian, I need you to make sure this person gets to this meeting on Saturday at 9 a.m. Meeting time came Saturday at 9 a.m., and the person wasn't there, and he said, where is so-and-so? I said, they couldn't make it. What really happened was I didn't tell them to come. But I was new to the role, I was nervous, young, didn't want to let him down, so I lied. The very next day, Sunday, he was at church and I saw him. And he said, I talked to him. He said, you never invited him. I said, I'm sorry. I lied. I apologize. And he said these words to me. Brian, don't make me have to worry about your integrity. It was as though after I picked my face up off the floor, I then began to realize how powerful our words were. That one lie to him, after doing things the best I could before, he taught me a very important lesson at that moment in my life and juncture. How words matter. That one lie can change someone's whole view about you. One lie can wreck an entire relationship. At the same time, one positive word. I believe in you. I can see it in you. God has his hand on your life. Our words are so powerful that they can shape both our lives and the lives of those that we love. The truth of the matter is that all of us can agree that all of us are a work in progress. Now, there's nobody in the room that's on the honor roll when it comes to your words. But all of us are trying to get better and improve better. Because the truth of the matter is this. If all of us want better relationships, whether it's our friendships or our family or in the workplace or our business or in our church family, and here's the reality, our words, they shape all of those relationships. Those words are at the core of building a relationship that we all long to have. So it's no surprise that James, as he writes about so many key areas, when he comes to talking about faith, he says your faith and your words are always connected. And so I want us to lean in today because I believe all of us can do better. And I believe that James gives us a framework. He gives us a game plan so that you and I can honor God more fully in our words. Here's the first principle out of the text. My words are a measure of my maturity. He gets to James 1 and 2. He says to them, listen. He says, listen here. He puts it real simply. If you can get your words in line, you can control your whole life. He says it to so degree that when he gets to verse 1, he says, that's why teachers will be judged more strictly. He says, because if you go teach it, there's an expectation that you got to at least live what you're teaching. So he says to us, the reality is this, that if you can get your words in order, if I can get my words and my thoughts in the right place, if you and I can get our words in the right place, where your words are, speak about your maturity and your relationship with God. That they are always connected together. And so that's why James says, let me start right here. When you talk about faith, James, what about evangelism? What about prayer? What about giving? What about serving? What about missions? What about what I do for the poor? What about justice issues? He says, no. Start with your words first. He says, your words, they shape and they transform and they position us. They are a measure of where you are in your spiritual life. If you want to measure your faith, look at your words. Here's the next one out of the text. My words are powerful, so be careful. Look at it, it happens in the text. He keeps saying it this way. He says, look at the ship. The ship is large, but it got a real small rudder that controls it. He says, consider the horse. It's over 1,000 pounds, large horse. But the little bitty 3 to 4 inch bit in his mouth controls the whole thing. He says, your words, your tongue may be small, but it has a big impact. He says, so be careful what you have because you have a deadly weapon in your mouth. Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. He's trying to help us to understand, don't minimize your words because our words have power. Here's the next piece. Our words can be destructive, so be constructive. Look at verses 5 and 6. He says, it's like a great forest that's set on fire. That great forest fire was started with one spark. September 2020, there was a couple that was having a baby reveal, gender reveal party in the backyard. As they so would have it, they would set off fireworks or use a smoke bomb to be able to declare it. and it lit a small blade of grass. But when that fire was done, it would burn 23,000 acres. 15 buildings claimed the life of one firefighter, but it all started with one spark. This text says our words will spark things. Either our words will spark great things, like your words can be used to build a great friendship, to build a great relationship, to build a great marriage, to build a great business, to build a great church, to build a great community nonprofit. Or our words can be a spark to tear something down. They can spark depression and anxiety. They can spark insecurity and issues and doubt and self-doubt. It can either be something that builds or something that breaks. Here's the next one, friends. Our words are uncontrollable, so be controlled by the Spirit. Let me give you a verse to write down as you think about this. Ephesians 5, verse 8. I want you to write that down just as a note. Right here it is. He says in verse 7, he takes us to the zoo and to SeaWorld in verses 7 and 8. He says they can train anything. Animals and bears and lions and tigers. He said, you've been to SeaWorld. They got dolphins flipping forward. He says, don't go there. Look at your own dog at the house. You can train anything. He said, but that tongue? Untamable by man or woman. He says you can't tame it. It's full of deadly poison. It always wants to say something. It won't just sit still, and it just has to butt in. It don't even be you talking. You just got to say something for somebody else's situation. It just can't. I just got to get this off my chest. Just sit still. Nobody ask you nothing. But that tongue, it can't be left out the party. He says it's untamable by a man or a woman. We cannot tame it. Well, if we can't tame it, what are we supposed to do? Well, he's trying to help us to understand that in your natural power, in your own human abilities, that you don't have the capacity to do it on your own. That the only way you're able to control your tongue is by you, first of all, having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it is that relationship with Jesus Christ and being indwelt by the Spirit of God that then gives you the power to control your tongue, because you can't do it, but God can. That's what he's saying. Because here's the deal, friends. Words aren't just words. Words are not just empty things that we say. Words are often sourced in our hearts. That's why some people that go off on you all the time are always on edge. It really is not even about you. It's about something they've got in their own hearts that they're trying to work through, that you're trying to deal with, and they take it out on you. And even us, when stuff comes up sometimes it's been in there the whole time, but what was in there wasn't about the person in front of us. It was about some stuff we were already dealing with, and they just caught it because they showed up at that time. And so unless your heart gets right, unless your mind gets right, what comes out your mouth will never matter, because it starts in your heart and in your mind, and that's where Jesus comes in. When Jesus changes your heart and changes your mind and changes your life, then your words have to get better, because it happens from the inside out. This is what he's saying to us. He's trying to help us understand that if you just try to say, I'm going to hold my tongue, I'm not going to do this, it'll never work. He's saying you need something greater than yourself to handle your words, and it's found in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And when stuff comes out that don't check right, it might mean we need to get closer to him and depend on him. Matter of fact, Lord, guide my lips. Lord, give me what to say. Lord, give me the right tone. Lord, give me the right timing. Lord, give me the right words. Help me to not say too much. You got to depend on God. When you're in those situations, you got to pray before you even get in there. When you're in the midst of it, you can pray for somebody with your eyes open. So you can be looking at them right now, just praying, Lord, if you don't help me with this thing right here. You got to pray. You got to lean on the Lord to get you through, because he just said it's uncontrollable. Here's the last one, and I want to give you some other pieces. He says, our words can be inconsistent, so be consistent. Our words can be inconsistent, So be consistent. Verses 9 through 12, he unpacks this reality that our words can be inconsistent. He says, you're praising God, and then you're cursing people that look like God. He says, something wrong with that. He said, it shouldn't be that way. He said, it shouldn't be that the same tongue that praises God is the same tongue. He says, it shouldn't be that way. This cursing in the text is not cussing. This, y'all know cussing. This is cursing. This cursing in the text, it means to pronounce evil things on others. But both of them, they cousins. They all go together, right? But what he's saying is that our he says too many of us are bilingual. He's not talking about English and Spanish. He's saying there's something wrong with our bilingualness, that we've got to be consistent in how we talk to people and how we treat people and how we communicate with people. He says, because when God has come into your life, your faith starts, your faith flows out of you, and you're not the person that you used to be. So this is what he's saying. He says, so you and I got to try to be consistent. He says, these four. Now I want to spend the rest of my time giving you five habits to apply to your life and then five habits to avoid, all right? Here's the first one. First habit to apply is truth. Somebody say truth. You and I have to speak the truth. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15 says, speaking the truth in love. You and I have to make a habit of speaking the truth. That we can avoid, that if we want to have healthy, vibrant relationships, that it requires us to be, I like one writer puts it, honest, open, and transparent. Be honest about our feelings. I feel sad about this, or I feel anxious about this. Be honest about our actions. Be honest about our mistakes. But it requires that we be truth tellers to one another. That we be honest to one another. Say, this is what's going on. This is why I apologize. This is why I responded. It's not an excuse, but I've just been under a lot of stress right now. Or I feel like I'm being neglected. Or I feel really excited about what's happened. I got anxiety about where I am. But I'm feeling, if we're not truthful, we can never build relationships. If we're not truthful, we can never really connect with people. But being truthful is critical to us connecting with God, but also connecting with our friends and our family and church members. Being truthful is essential. Here's the next one, being kind. I would sub next to this word, positive. I mean, you'll find it there where he writes in Ephesians chapter 4, around verse 32, he'll say, be kind and compassionate to one another. The ideal here is to be caring, right? It is to be empathetic. And you guys know how these words affect us. When somebody says, are you okay? When somebody says, man, I love you, or I care about you, or how can I help? There is something about kindness that lets you let loosen the guard. Something about kindness or positive talk that influences you, gives you hope, gives you courage, gives you opportunity. There is something incredibly significant about kindness. Most people wake up with their cups empty. They're dealing with life and dealing with challenges. And when they get to work, many times what they are looking for is someone to help fill their cup with encouragement, with possibilities, with optimism, with faith. You know these people. There are certain people in your life. It is their encouragement that helps to give you hope, that helps to give you life, because there's power in kindness. Kindness is so powerful that the business community has grabbed a hold to it, because they know if they can get employees and their teams to treat people with courteous and hospitality, they can grow their business, because people only come back to places that treat them well. But that's not just a business concept. That's a concept that God has implanted in us that follow him. Here's the next one, respect. We ought to talk to people respectfully. We ought to talk to people as though they value, as though they matter. as though, you know, not I'm high up here and you down there, or you don't value that. No, we ought to speak to people with respect and value as though we have a care and a concern and an empathy. Respectfully. Here's the next one, friends. Listening. Listening. Listen, this is another tool that you need in your toolbox if you're going to be healthy in your communication. Listening. James 1 and verse 19 puts it this way. He says, my brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. That's James 1, verse 19. Listen to what James is saying. James is saying, listen, be quick to listen. Some of our challenges with communicating with each other will be solved if we would just put down our phones and just have a conversation. Some of our tensions and conflicts are worse because we go text our way through the situation. If we would just pick up the phone and sit down and have a conversation, we really could get somewhere if we would listen to one another and just really hear the other person out. Listening is an entire skill that we all need to develop. So many times when we're listening, we're so busy trying to think about the rebuttal so I can get you. We're so busy trying to pull receipts from our mind so that we can get them back instead of just listening to the person and hearing them out so we can respond in a better way. Listening is so important, friends, so us to be able to hear a person out. Sometimes your friend doesn't want your fixes or your solutions. Sometimes the only thing they want is to be heard and listened to by you. Sometimes they just want to be heard, to be listened. Here's the last gift that you need in your toolbox is silence. Somebody say silence. There's a whole lot of ways we could have said that word, but we're gonna keep it real nice and silence. Sometimes we just need to be quiet. Sometimes the best thing we can do is to be quiet. That's why in James 1:19, he says simply this way. He says, be quick to listen and slow to speak. Proverbs 17:28 says, even the fool was counted wise when he held his peace. When he shuts his lips, he's considered perceptive. Sometimes we just need to be quiet. Sometimes we don't need to say another word. We don't need to bring it up again. We don't need to prove one more point. Because how many of us have been victims when we were that one more point just lit the whole phrase? If we had stopped about 30 seconds prior, the relationship wouldn't be in the point that it is. He's saying that sometimes just be quiet. Don't say another word. When the Holy Spirit told you to stop talking, just listen and say, I'm done. It's simply saying you've reached a point in the conversation where you feel like if you say anything else, it's going to hurt the situation. So give me a minute. Let me be quiet. Let me regroup, and we can follow up another time if we need to. But right now, the best thing I can do is just close my mouth and be quiet. Habits to apply. And I want to give you five habits to avoid. These are five things that you and I need to avoid when it comes to our conversations, right? The first one is lying. Lying. Ephesians 5:25 says, put off falsehood. It means put off lies and speak the truth. Lying is so commonplace today, it just happens all the time. We lie on resumes, lie a job, lie about fake boyfriends, girlfriends, lie at work, lie at home, lie at church. I mean, lie in social media posts, lie in text messages, just lie. We lie so much today that sometimes we lie and can't remember what we lied about, so then we can't even put our lies together. And he simply tells us that this should not be who we are. Psychologists tell us that 90% of children can grasp the concept of lying by age 4. By age 4, they done figured it out. That one study said that 60% of adults can't have a 10-minute conversation without lying at least once. Then another study said that one study in Britain says that men lie 6 times a day and women lie 3 times a day. I that's questionable. I don't know. I don't know about that one. I bet. I don't know. but we're going to leave that alone. I'm sorry, brothers. Sorry about that. And the number one lie told was, nothing's wrong, I'm fine. We have to figure out how to stop the lies. We lie for so many reasons. We lie because we want to protect our image. We lie because we're trying to avoid trouble. We lie some because some people are just liars pathologically, and they lie about everything. But you and I must become truth tellers. We don't want lies to devalue the relationship, to devalue our character. You and I must avoid lying at all costs. Not only lying, but here's the next one, anger and bitterness. Anger and bitterness, Ephesians 4:31 says, get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger and brawling and slander along with every form of malice. Whenever we end up in this angry, bitter place, we're in a dangerous place. When we get to this point where we are raging and verbally attacking people and cussing people out and going off, things never end well here. The problem is we live in a world that tells us this is the way you ought to solve your problems. We watch reality TV shows where people are going crazy and fussing and cussing and yelling as though that will help you solve your problem. No, that's how you lose your job. That's how you lose the relationship. That's how you lose who you are. That's how you catch a case. I mean, it does not work the way we think it works. So when we find ourselves with these issues and with these struggles, we got to ask ourselves, what's really going on? What's making me so angry? What is it in my heart, in my mind, that's pushing me in this direction? What's making me try to solve all my problems by just going to 100 and just going to 10 and just going off on everything? Sometimes you got to do some soul searching. Sometimes you need to back up, take a break, catch your breath, count to 10, say, give me a minute, I only need to go there right now. But sometimes you got to reassess yourself so that we're not functioning out of this. Sometimes you may need counseling to figure out what's happening in my heart and my mind that's going on. But we got to figure out, we cannot live in that space. That space is not a healthy space. It's not where God called us to. Here's the next one, criticism and gossip. Some people got the gift of criticism, and they just can, they just can kill the whole vibe. They just come in, and it can be a perfectly good situation, but the moment they start talking and criticizing everybody, and then sometimes they ain't even put in on any of it, but got the nerve to criticize how it was done and the way it was done and somebody's birthday party, and they talking about a dress or putting it down. And like, dude, that ain't what we're here for. And that's why you get left out the text thread. Because we can't deal with all the criticism and the negativity, and everything got to be about you. And you gotta bring everything so it focuses on you. Criticism, it deflates everything. And so you and I don't want to be that person. You and I don't want to be that person that is constantly critical and nitpicking because it doesn't fit your faith. I'm not saying you can't speak truth and love and provide constructive criticism. That's not what it's saying. The text is saying that it shouldn't be your habit that you feel like you got to correct and critique every single thing. Criticism and this other one, gossip, go right next to each other. They're closely related because gossip is when we feel like we got to spill the tea, we got to share the inside scoop, we got to tell you what we heard, we assume we got some kind of power or some access to insider information that makes us privileged, and now we want to tell everything. But here is the problem with people that are gossip. The old folk would say, every dog that brings a bone will take a bone. What that simply means is that person you listen to all that gossip about, it's the same person that's gonna take your private information too and take it as well to somewhere else. Gossip doesn't fit us. Here's the next one, disrespect. Disrespect. You and I have to avoid disrespecting others in our words and in our conversations. Disrespect shows up in both the tone or the tenor or the way that you say it. Disrespect is rolling the eyes. It's waving our hands. It's being rude to somebody. It's being put downs. It's being derogatory. It's being disrespectful, because all of us were created with respect. God has put us, we are made in his image, which means we all carry dignity. So we deserve that until proven otherwise. So when we talk down to people like they ain't on our level and they ain't done all this and you wouldn't understand all that, what that does is that disrespect. Some of y'all are good at it until somebody does it to you. Then you like, listen, you go come. That's how you want to come. That's how we're doing this. You like, listen, hey, I was doing good till you came at like how you came at me. And now that you came at me like you came at me, I'm about to meet you right where you are, right? I mean, and then you go write your own diss track and you go publish it too. This is not us. Because when people get disrespected, they feel like they got to retaliate and we push them into a corner. This is not who God called you to be. This is not where we function. This is not where he needs us to be. Here's the last one, friends. Silence. You're going to say, wait a minute. How does this fit on both lists? Because silence can be weaponized. Silence can turn into a weapon. And I'm going to freeze you out and not talk to you. Not because I'm done talking, but because I want you to feel hurt from me by me not talking to you. My wife and I, when we first got married, we used to do this play this silent treatment game until we realized how detrimental it could be to a relationship. We didn't know better. We were early marriage, and we were freezing each other out. It might be days, we just not talking to each other. I remember one time we were going to church, and we weren't talking to each other. We woke up, got dressed, came, drove all the way to church, not talking. Sit down, not talking, until the worship leader started singing some song and talking about, sing to your neighbor, I need you, I want you. Like, hey, man, I ain't talking to her. This is what you do. We play these games, right, in relationships. And then the crazy part about it, when you're not talking to each other, but when the phone ring, everything is normal. Hey, how you doing? Yeah, I'm good. Yeah. Oh, they doing good too. Yeah. Not talking to them. Then you freeze them out as soon as you get off the phone all over again. This is the crazy games that we play when we make silence a weapon. And we ignore a person or punish a person or diminish a person. This is something we don't want to get into that game because it never ends well. If we're not gonna talk, then let's just, but silence is different from boundaries. You do need boundaries in your life for some relationships that may not be in a healthy place. And sometimes you do have to protect yourself. That's different than this. But friends, silence can't be weaponized against another person because it can cause more problems. Friends, I know we've covered a lot of ground and to try to help, but I just believe that all of us have room to grow in this area. Let me close by telling you this poem that I read that I found. Listen to this poem. A careless word may kindle strife. A cruel word may wreck a life. A bitter word may hate and steal. A brutal word may smite and kill. But a gracious word may soothe the way. A joyous word may light the day. A timely word may lessen stress. And a loving word may heal and bless. Friends, our words have power. Choose your words wisely. Amen and praise God. All right, family, I want to ask you to jump in on this message today, and I want to invite you to grab your phones if you will, and I want you to text two people. I want you to text two people, somebody that came to mind that you want to encourage, and use your words to be a blessing to them, to be an encouragement to them. Or maybe it's somebody that you need to reconcile with and you can't put it all in the text, but you can just say, hey, man, I just thought about you or I just thought about her. But would you grab your phone right now and just text those two people, even right now while we sit here? I want to encourage. This is, I want you to apply just what we talked about and use your words to be a blessing. Use your words to build. Use your words to strengthen. Or maybe somebody else came to your heart and mind and you said, you know what? I can't put it all in the text, but I just want you to know I'm thinking about you. And I want to connect with you later on. But wherever you are, whatever the Lord has placed on your heart, would you grab your phone and send those two messages right now? And once you've sent those two messages, I want to invite you just to take a moment of prayer. It could be a text message of encouragement where you're encouraging somebody, or it could be something else. Just send those two messages, and then once you finish, would you just take a moment of prayer right where you are and just ask the Lord to use your words, confess your words to him, and say, Lord, I want to grow in this area. I need you, Lord. I'm depending on you. Give me the courage to say what needs to be said. Help me not to sit on it, but to trust you. Come on, would you begin to send those messages and then have a moment of prayer right where you are? Maybe it's a friendship. Maybe it's a girlfriend in your life, and you and y'all been sisters for long, friends for a long time, but y'all been going through something right now, and you're just thinking about it. So maybe it's that, or maybe it's the friend that has been your source, your rock, your ride or die, and you just need to tell them, thank you for being you in my life. Come on, take a moment right now. Let's do that. Father, we come to you in this room. We pray for every text message that we sent, Lord. We pray for that person that we just needed to encourage and let them know how much they mean to us. Let them know how much we treasure them. To let them know how proud we are of them, and to let them know that we are praying for them and believing what you have in store for their lives. So, Father, thank you for the text message that may have said, I just need to connect a little bit later on. We pray for that maybe someone has said something they shouldn't, or maybe someone has spoken to someone in a disrespectful way. I thank you, Lord, that you sent your word today to convict us, to remind us of the work we all have to do. And so, Father, I pray for every one of us in this room. First of all, Lord, I just confess our own sins, my own sins, in not saying always the truth fully. Not always being as respectful as needed to be, not telling lies, Lord, just not being as clear and not, Father, I confess all of our sins in this room, that Lord, we are all guilty at some point, at some juncture of gossiping and all of this. So Father, right now, we commit to you that we need you. We commit to you that we can't do it by ourselves. We commit that we can't blame everybody and say, man, you pushing my buttons or they took me there. But Lord, I pray that you may give us a level of self-control with our words and with our tongues. We pray, Lord, that we may be people that are building others up, not just tearing people down. We pray, Lord, that you may help us to speak the truth, but do it in love. We pray, God, for our friendships. We pray for our marriages. We pray for our children as we raise them up. We pray, God, for our extended family, God. We pray for our co-workers. We pray for our church members. We pray, oh God, that you would do a work in our lives every single day with our words that are clearly indicative that it was you at work in our lives. And Father, I thank you for the testimonies that already exist in this room, that there are already those in this room that can say, Lord, I've already seen you do a work. And I trust you for the work you are still doing. We love you and we honor you, Lord. It's in your son Jesus' name that we say this prayer, and all those who agreed said amen. Come on, can you give God praise in advance for what he's going to do? Amen. And now, family, I'm going to ask you to please stand with me. And I'm going to ask you not to walk at this very important time, because somebody in the room needs to make a decision today. Somebody in this room, you've been thinking about this decision all week, or perhaps you've been thinking about it today, but somebody in this room doesn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Somebody in this room has never surrendered their life to Jesus Christ. Today, we were able to celebrate 30 people that got baptized and said yes to Jesus today. And we celebrate all of those that got baptized. But today, that could be your story. You know you need Jesus in your life. You've been trying to do it on your own, but it won't work until you say yes to Jesus and surrender your life to him. And the Bible says you ain't got to get yourself together. You just come like you are, put your faith in him to be your Lord and your leader and your Savior. If you're in this room today and you're ready for a fresh start, if you're in this room today and you got questions about your relationship with him, but you want to get those questions answered, or you're in this room today and you don't have a church family, you've been hopping from church to church, or you've been with us, but you're not connected, we would love to have you today. I want to invite you, if that's you, grab your stuff right where you are and meet me right here at this altar. I'm going to pray with you, and then we'll lead you through how you take your next step with Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you want to give your life to Jesus, you want to get baptized, you want to join this church family, would you come right now? Come on, we are waiting on you. Our music ministry is going to minister as they sing. That's your cue. Come on, family, we invite you. Meet us right here today. Come on, grab your stuff and start walking. Come on, wherever you are. Yes. Come on, we invite you today.
And it reaches.
Yes.
To me.
We invite you. We invite
on,
you. We invite you.
Are,
you. Come on.
You are my strength.
Yes.
Strength
we invite you.
Like no
say yes to him.
Strength like no
come on.
Other.
Say
strength
yes
like
to him.
Say, strength like no other.
Come on.
It
say yes to him.
Reaches to me.
That's right.
Come
that's
on.
Right. Church. They say no. Say I'll walk as if you want me to. Would you check with your neighbor right quick? Come on, you're not talking to your neighbor. And check with your neighbor just right quick. Let's make sure just in case there might be one more person in the room that wants to come but doesn't want to walk by themselves. Anybody else in the room that wants to say yes to Jesus? I see one more coming on that side. Come on, anybody else in the room that want to say yes to Jesus? That wants to give your life to him? Anybody else in the room? Amen. 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 Come on, family. Let's celebrate every decision that's coming. I see there's some more coming now. Come on. Anybody else in the room who want to say yes to Jesus? Come on. Anybody else in the room that want to say yes to Jesus. Come on, that's it. Come on, family. Come on, come on, family. Praise God. Praise God. And excited for your decision to say yes to Jesus Christ. We celebrate your yes to Jesus. We celebrate your yes to getting connected to a church family. This is so important of your journey, and we are praising God for every decision on this day. I want to pray for you, and then we'll go from there. Okay, family, let's pray. Father, I thank you right now for the yeses that stand at this altar. I thank you right now for the decision to say yes to you, to trust their lives to you, to follow after you. So Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I give you right now every brother, every sister that stands at this altar. I give them to you and I say, Lord, please walk with them, guide them, direct them, show them, lead them, bless them in every way possible. Lord, they are yours. And so, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we ask, God, would you lead them? Would you guide them? Would you direct them? Would you bless their family, bless their finances, bless their relationships, bless their career, bless their walk with you, bless their relationship with themselves? Lord, we pray right now that you will use them and honor them and walk with them as only you can. We thank you, God. In Jesus' name, we say this prayer. Amen. All right, family, let's welcome all of our family members today. Take your seats right where you are. A couple of things and then we'll be dismissed together. Can we celebrate one more time the harvest the Lord provided on today? Amen, amen, amen. And while you're celebrating, all those that were baptized, would you please stand? All those that were baptized, would y'all stand so we can celebrate? Woo! Congratulations. Couple quick things. First thing I want to say is I want to thank all of those who helped serve our seniors. Thank you, Pastor Williams, for helping to lead all of our we served over 500 senior citizens yesterday, our Life Ministry 55 plus. So thank you for helping us to serve and minister to them on yesterday. I also want to acknowledge a couple of people. Mark Cooks, I think he may have had to leave, but Mark Cooks is running for mayor of Duncanville, and early voting starts on tomorrow. He's an incredible servant leader, both in our church and in our community. So remember him in your prayers during this election season. Early voting starts tomorrow. Also, if you live in the city of Dallas, there's a bond election that's in front of us, and the bond election is worth $1.25 billion. Those are all the projects. It's all about infrastructure. It's all about investing. About 75% of it goes to roads, parks, and public safety. And so your support for this bond will go a long way to help improve and invest in our community. And there's no tax increase with it. So that's even better, right? So that's it. That's the best part about the whole deal, right? So I wanted you to be aware of that during this important election season. Dr. Keisha O'Reilly, she's still here. Dr. Keisha O'Reilly, she's a candidate for Dallas College Board of Trustees, District 7. So keep her in your prayers and remember her during this election season. Such a faithful servant. Thank you so much, Dr. O'Reilly. And then Shirley Robinson, a candidate for DeSoto City Council, Place 6. She was at the earlier service. So remember all of those individuals in your prayers during this election season. All right, family, we thank God for you. Remember, use this week to meditate on James 3, verses 1 through 12, right? Each week, we are, as we go through a passage of Scripture, we want to encourage you to read that passage of Scripture as a meditation throughout the week, right, to kind of help guide us and direct us, all right? We pray y'all have a great and amazing week. We gotta pray for our Mavs, y'all. We got a good series coming up, y'all. We can do this. We got a few more weapons than we had last time. So that game's on at 2:30 today. So I'm going to go home and check that out, going for my Mavs. All right. All right, family, come on. Pastor Benny's going to come and close us out at this time. Pastor Benny, thank you so much.
All right, family. I want to celebrate a couple of baby dedications. A couple of babies are being dedicated today. So Kimberly and Sam Parson are dedicating their daughter, Mackenzie Grace Parson. Can you help me praise God for that? Also, we have LaShonda Fletcher and DeWan Jackson dedicating their son, Halo Jackson. Amen. Praise God for that. And we've got Brittany and Derek Harlan dedicating their daughter, Journey Harlan. Amen. Amen. We've got Kay Nikki Andrews, who's dedicating her daughter, Chloe Andrews. And we also have some special guests here today. I believe they're in the building, West Helena Acres High School, class of 1987. If you're in here, would you please stand? Come on, come on. There they are. We want to celebrate you all on today. Super grateful for you all for joining us for worship. Young adults, be sure to pull up to the table this Wednesday, 7 p.m. at On the Levee. Yeah, I hear you, young adults. Make sure y'all follow thetable.dfw on Instagram to stay connected. All right? Also, every third Sunday, our next-gen youth serve in different capacities throughout the service. And so today, we want to highlight one of our Concord kids, Zamaya Douglas, and the Mighty Mustangs. They advanced to the Destination Imagination State Finals for the second year in a row. Come on, y'all. Zamaya and her team have worked together to creatively complete an open academic challenge in the fields of STEM. And Zamaya, we just want you to know your Concord family is super godly, proud of you, and we're just grateful for all the work that you're doing. All right? Also, first-time visitors, we have a special gift for you. If you didn't receive it already, be sure to stop by our visitor's booth out in the foyer on your way out. And then also, I just want to make sure that, family, you guys are inviting somebody to service with you, right? If you have questions about getting involved at Concord, stop by the Next Steps room in the foyer for information on grow groups, information on classes, information on serving, and much more. And to our online worshipers, stay connected by visiting our website, all right? Lastly, we believe in the power of prayer. Immediately after the blessing, if there is anyone needing prayer, our team will be available up front to connect with you in prayer. If you're tuning in online, the prayer link is in the chat. All right? All right. So I've got one of our Concord kids here with me that's going to do our blessing. If you all will stand with me as we prepare to be dismissed.
Did y'all enjoy this service? Hi, my name is Kaelin Harris, and I'm in the second grade, and I'm going to do the blessing today. Numbers 6, 24 through 26. Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Have a great week.
You did the impossible.
my family's leaning on me.
I've had to be strong for everybody else.
But I'm praying, can you please help me?
Say, do it yourself.
If I could.